Good morning and welcome. Happy Easter. He is risen. He's risen indeed. I thought that was even going to be a little bit louder, but that's okay. It's so good to be together this morning. This is just such a special morning. If you're new, we want to especially say welcome to you, and we're really glad to have you with us. We'd love to meet you either up at the front after the service or out on the plaza, where we have a gift for you at the Welcome Center. Thanks for being with us. For all of us, we remind ourselves each week at Grace that we want to be a Christ-centered community intent on proclaiming the gospel, making disciples, and sacrificially serving Jesus. So that's what we want to do this morning. Just a few announcements to mention before we begin this morning. First, if you see Jason McAllister, Jared Miklia, or Rebecca Clark, just welcome them as new members at Grace. Oh, and I've missed Kristen Liu. Sorry, Kristen. You're also a new member, so exciting to welcome them. Also want to mention that the budget has been confirmed for this next fiscal year, and that'll begin tomorrow. Outside in the NPR, don't miss today, some nice, like, goodies to eat, as well as some calendars outside to pick up for free. The Fieldhouse Project continues to march forward. They're pouring concrete for the foundation soon. And the last thing to mention is that today is the first day to sign up for VBS this coming summer. So if you have kids or know someone who has kids, today is when signups open, and we're really looking forward to that. So with that, would you please stand with me if you're able, and we're going to begin our service reading from God's Word from Psalm 16. We're going to read verses 1 and 2, and then verses 9 through 11. Psalm 16, starting in verse 1. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. And then verse 9. Therefore my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure, for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Father, we know that life and joy, pleasures forevermore, are at your right hand and exist in your presence alone. And we know that our access to your presence is dependent on the reality of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so we want to, especially this morning, like we do each week and even every day, remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the one who is the only Savior of the world. We want to remember and worship him this morning, and we pray that he would receive glory among us as we worship. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, Grace. It's a joy to see you this morning, and we invite you to join us in singing that Jesus is alive.
Bells are ringing and they're singing that we can be born again. Hear the bells.
I'm
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Ephesians chapter 4, and I invite you to turn there with me. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 10. We'll remain standing out of honor for God and His perfect word. I've also been asked to mention, if there's any room next to you, if you could slide to just make room for anybody who's still joining us, that would be really helpful. Ephesians chapter 4, starting in verse 1. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower regions, the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. And let's pray together this morning. Lord Jesus, we want to worship you as your people this morning. You are the one who has ascended. You are risen. You've passed through death triumphant and emerged into life on the other side, and you will take your people with you into life. Lord, we're so thankful. We want to every day of our lives to worship you as the unquestioned Lord of all. You are the King of the universe. You are the one who sits at the right hand of the Father, and you've been exalted to that place of power, reigning until you place every enemy under your feet. And Lord, we desire to give you all praise and honor and glory this morning. Thank you for the hope that your resurrection extends to us. Thank you that if you have been raised, we can have confidence that those of us who've trusted in Christ will be raised as well, and that death has lost all of its sting. Where, O death, is your sting? We have a victory through you, Lord Jesus, and we praise you. Thank you that we don't need to fear death or even all the pain of this world, that you've promised to your people eternal life with you. And Lord, we worship you, we thank you, we pray that as we are gathered together this morning, that your Spirit would work powerfully by the preaching of your word, as well as our singing together, our praying, our fellowship, to give us eyes to see your glory. Lord, we want to see how wonderful you are. We want our hearts to be comforted and encouraged by the reality of your resurrection as the triumphant King of all. Lord, would you humble us this morning? Would you show us again that you are worthy of all of our trust and all of our obedience? Lord, we confess that we sin against you in many ways, and we pray this morning that as we remember and rejoice in your resurrection and ascension and exaltation, Lord, we pray that you would draw us back to yourself, to trust you, to be satisfied in your love, to desire to live lives that would be pleasing to you and reflect your goodness and kindness toward us. Lord, we also just think of right now all your church gathered around the world, and especially those that we know of through supported missionaries and missions partners. And Lord, we lift them up as well. We pray that you would bless your people as your church gathers around the world. We pray for many people who don't know you, who are still lost, who are going to be hearing your gospel preached today, the good news of Christ dying and rising again. And Lord, we just ask for your Spirit to powerfully work to draw people to trust in Christ. And even among us here this morning, we pray that you would work powerfully in that way. Lord, we're thankful for your grace in our lives. We're thankful for the mercy that you've shown us in Christ. And Father, we pray that you would have your way in our hearts this morning as your word is preached, so that Jesus Christ would receive honor and glory and praise. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand if you're able once more and join us as we sing Because He Lives?
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon, an empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives.
Because he
You're the Father of all believers. We come to Jesus, who's risen and exalted because he lives. Come to the Holy Spirit, who is with us now. And we remember, Jesus, your life, no condescension, no more amazing. There was no mercy more abundant. There was no compassion more overflowing. No obedience to the law more precise, more perfect. And even still, there was no death more painful. There was no torture more gruesome. There was no humiliation more lowly. And so we rejoice today. The victory of your resurrection. There is no victory more wonderful. There is no life more alive than yours. There is no power that's greater, no name that's more exalted than the name of Jesus, at whose name every knee will bow and tongue will confess. We look forward to this time in your word and ask for eyes to see and ears to hear. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Greetings. Greetings in the name of Jesus Christ, our only hope. To believing friends, unbelieving friends, and those I have not yet had the opportunity to meet, today we remember Jesus Christ risen from the dead. And I don't know the condition of your soul. You may say there's no difference between me and you. And maybe it will all shake out in the wash. You may say that what works for you, and that you've got your own system, your own program. Well, how's your program working for you? When your head hits the pillow, what secures you? When I'm around a lot of people, sometimes I think, wow, you know, we look all similar and we're going through things, and we all have hopes and dreams and aspirations and different gifts and abilities and all of that. But the thought that strikes me when I'm in a big group is, who among us is going to heaven? What really matters is who we belong to for eternity. If you're a believer, what I'm about to say is the basis for your assurance. If you're an unbeliever, it may well be the difference between life and death, heaven and hell. We're going to look at two verses today, in Ephesians chapter 4 in the New Testament, and verses 9 and 10. And these two verses tell us the most important truth in the universe. Why everything revolves around Jesus Christ, why he's preeminent, why you must bow before him, why you must believe in him, why you must surrender to him, why you must follow him by faith. Jesus died for sin, rose again, and reigns now. He descended, he ascended to fill all things. He was born to die, risen to life, and ruling now and forever. And I just want to break those things down as we see in these verses. Verses 9 and 10, it's talking about Christ descending. It's talking about Christ ascending. It's talking about Christ filling all things. So first, he descended. The idea is that he was born to die, that Jesus died for sin. If you would, if you in your Bible, and you might have your Bible with you or find a Bible in front of you there, if you look at verse 9 and really fix your eyes on verse 9, see what it's saying. Here's what it says. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? Now, that phrase, the lower parts of the earth, have puzzled a lot of people. A lot of people are worried about the meaning and they don't know what it means. There have been a lot of discussions, a lot of doctrines built off of that one phrase. If you're familiar with the Apostles' Creed, what it says is that Jesus descended into hell. A lot of people who say that creed don't know what that means. Now, we need to worship God intelligently, and so what this forces us to do is a good thing. Think it through. And some say one thing about this phrase, and Some say another, and there are many things that are said about this phrase. For example, some say that it refers to Jesus' virgin birth. Other people say it refers to the incarnation, when God the Son became a man in the person of Jesus Christ. Others say that what he did was set free the Old Testament believers that were held captive since death and brought them out and raised them himself. That was a view very popular in the early church. It was based on 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 19 and 18 and 19 that says this: "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the Spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in heaven." Now, other people will say those verses and this phrase we're looking at has to do with him going into hell, like the Apostles' Creed says. You know, hell is down, heaven is up, and all of that. Something he went down into hell to proclaim salvation to certain persons who were there. That he preached the gospel to people who were destroyed in the flood in the days of Noah, to give them a second chance to repent and believe. Others will take it even further and say, well, there's going to be a second chance and further opportunity for everyone to repent and believe after they die. Untrue. The Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. You don't get a second chance after you die. Another explanation of this phrase is that Jesus did not go down to hell to preach the gospel, but to proclaim victory over the devil and all the inmates in hell and how he overcame God's enemies. This was an idea that was put forth in history, all these ideas put forth throughout the years, throughout the centuries. And people are puzzled. They don't know how to understand it. They don't all agree on it. But we can't skip over this. We can't pretend like it doesn't matter. We can't, dismiss it and not think it through. It means something. Yet I do not believe it means any of the things I've already mentioned. I don't think it means all those other things that everyone says it means. Some come close, and what I want to say is that there should be no unnecessary speculation about what the Lord Jesus Christ did or did not do after his death and before his resurrection. And it crept into the creeds, speculation, with no scriptural proof. That verse in Peter was telling the recipients of his letter that judgment was coming. And he was talking about the two great judgments that have happened, that one has happened in the history of the world, another is coming. The first great judgment was the Genesis flood, came upon the whole world. The second great judgment will be when the world will, be melting with intense heat, with fervent heat at the final judgment. And what he is telling them is Jesus Christ is the vehicle for salvation today, just like the ark was the vehicle of deliverance in the days of Noah, coming through the flood. And the conditions of Christians in the world today is similar to right before the flood, because we are being confronted with the gospel truth that you need to flee from the wrath to come. That God's wrath is coming upon mankind's sin. The wrath was put on Christ at the cross, but if you don't have Christ, the wrath will go on you. Warning people to flee from the wrath to come. And so, taking all of that, when you look at that phrase in verse 9, what does that mean? That he descended into the lower parts of the earth. I think that means death itself. That he died for sins. You can't say that Ephesians 4:9 refers to Jesus going and preaching in hell. That's speculation. That's theory. There's nothing in Scripture to substantiate it. Nothing to suggest that he freed people held captive after they died. Again, it's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. And this is a good lesson on how to handle Scripture. If you focus on some micro-individual phrase, you sometimes will miss the main point. Think of it. When was the conquering of the devil and the powers in hell accomplished? It happened at the cross. Colossians 2 says, at the cross he made a spectacle of the principalities and powers, literally made a show of them. He openly triumphed over them in his death on the cross. It was at the cross that Jesus cried out, "It is finished." There was nothing left to be completed in hell. The work was completed at the cross. So what we are dealing with here is a very graphic, pictorial description of Christ coming down to earth to die. Christ came to save sinners. Christ came to give his life for the world. When our Lord was on earth, he was speaking to Nicodemus once, and he said, "I have come down from heaven." He came to give his life for the world. In that day, Roman culture was filled with all sorts of stories of descending into the underworld. This is about descent to death. God came down to earth. Jesus came to die. Descent is death. It's not the incarnation. It's not only that. It's the coming to earth to die, born to die, and dying. So the lower regions of the earth is the grave. It is death. It's the result of Christ's cross work. Christ, who was with God before the foundation of the world, and he went from his glorious eternal existence with God to earth's humble existence to die in our place. 1 Timothy 1:15, Christ came to save sinners. That something real happened, that Christ died, that murder was perpetrated by evil people, and it was predetermined by God before the world began. The death of death in the death of Christ, because hell is real. It's because hell is real. Don't blink twice on that. It's true. Recently, Pope Francis was asked, earlier this year even, what he thinks about hell. His answer was, well, it's difficult to imagine hell. Personally, I'd like to think hell is empty. I hope it is. Which prompted Lance Morrow to comment on March 7th, 2024, this month, in a Wall Street Journal opinion piece, he said, that was a pastoral pleasantry. It was kindly meant, but theologically sloppy. I would say theologically untrue. And he says it raised interesting questions. Has the traditional hell, the fire and brimstone throughout all eternity, gone out of business? Either because, as the Pope hopes, there is no longer enough customers, or because hell has become not credible to the 21st century mind? And then he asks this question, is there such a thing as eternal life? And if God's verdict goes against you, does that mean everlasting torment? To which we will give a resounding scriptural yes. And if you're wondering today, I wouldn't chance it. The Son of God can rescue you from hell. Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Trust your soul to him. He purchased freedom for sin's captives at the cross. Without the shedding of blood, Hebrews 9:22, there is no forgiveness. The blood was shed. So let the forgiveness of Christ flood your life today. He descended. Christ died for sin. He was born to die. That's the first part. Second part. Second of three. Second part. He ascended. He was risen to life. He rose again and now seated at the right hand of God, the Father. Look at verse 10. If you look at verse 10, it says, he who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens. Something real happened there. Christ was resurrected. It was predetermined by God. And then he ascended to the right hand of the Father, above the heavens. The God's glory was reaching to every corner of the universe. Jesus said to Nicodemus in John 3, no one has ascended into heaven but he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, must the Son of Man be lifted up on the cross, so that whoever believes will in him have eternal life. Peter's preaching on the day of Pentecost. Acts 2 records it. Let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. He descended to take our sin upon himself. He ascended victorious over sin and death and hell and Satan, so that all who believe would have life in him. And those who do not believe will not have that life. John put it this way: if you have the Son of God, you have the life. If you do not have the Son of God, you do not have the life. Christ's resurrection is essential to our faith. You don't want to show up at Easter service and say, I'm a Christian, but I don't believe in the resurrection. That's not possible. Easter, you know, you say, I believe in the resurrection. And I know that a lot of people like to wake up and say, he is risen. And what does everyone say back? Right. Why are we not saying that every day? Why do we wait once a year? What on Good Friday do we like, let's get really sad and act like we don't know how it turns out? We'd be quiet on Saturday, and on Sunday we'll say that, but we should be saying that every single day. When I woke up this morning, you know what I said? Thank you, Lord, that I have another day to serve you. Every day we remember the resurrection. Every day. A lot of people will say, you know, Easter, that's the Super Bowl for Christians. I'm like, what? No. No, every day is Resurrection Day. And we don't know the day or the hour that Jesus is coming back. So we better be praising God and saying, he is risen indeed, every single day in our hearts, in our homes, in our lives. I believe in the resurrection every day. If Christ is not raised, the scriptures which say he did are invalid. Jesus said, your word is truth. To the Father, the Son says, your word is truth. Isaiah 40 verse 8 says, the grass withers, the flower falls off, but the word of our God stands forever. Not one word will fall. Not one letter will fall down. If Christ is not raised, you are still in your sins, professing believer, and you're without hope. If Christ is not raised, your faith is futile. If Christ is not raised, you have no freedom from sin. If Christ is not raised, the church is dead. There's a social club, you know, with less golfing. The church's victory and eternal life rests upon the resurrection. He descended. Christ died for our sin, born to die. He ascended, risen to life, rose again. But I will tell you, this third point, by the way, here's what I'm doing today. Give you 1 point, 2 points, 3 points, and then I'll just hammer all three home for the rest of my time. I'm just going to keep saying the same thing over and over again in case you missed it the first time. Or if you loved it the first time, you'll get to hear it again. Number three, he fills all things. I bet you didn't think about that yet today. He rose from the dead. Absolutely true. Why did he do it? Look at verse 10 again. He descended. He's the one who also ascended far above all the heavens. Here's the purpose clause: that he might fill all things. That's what you need to know today. Easter's not like, hey, data points. Jesus died and rose again. All right, I'll take that, tuck that in my back pocket and go, and hopefully it'll help me out on a daily basis. No. He died and rose again to fill all things. You have to know what that means. If you're a Christian, you need to know what it means that Jesus fills all things. The death of Christ and the resurrection are not just static data points. They're not just static activities that happen and we refer back to. No, we are dealing, and you must deal with the risen, real, living Christ today, who is ruling right now. Let's say you're a Christian and you're like bitter. Let's say you're a Christian, you're not forgiving people. And you're like, oh, Jesus rose again, I better feel better now. Oh, Jesus rose again, he's reigning right now. You need to worry about this. You need to think about this. Be concerned with one thing. The one who ascended is the same person who descended to fill all things. The purpose for Christ's descent and ascent is that he might fill all things. And not like might fill, like, oh, well, I wonder if it's really going to happen or not. It's like, how many times do you watch a movie that you've seen before and go, I don't know how it ends? That's like, again, the people that only celebrate Easter once a year and get all excited once a year. It's like, you've seen this movie before. You know how it ends. You read it in your Bible. You know how it ends. You know, we're not playing pretend. We're not like, again, sad one day, silent one day, happy the next day, and then Monday just go back to normal. That he might fill all things. The idea is not that he might, is that he is. This is a present time. This is an action in the present time. This is an action that happened and continues to the present time. The idea is that his divine presence and his spirit is present everywhere. Literally, this is the one who fills for himself. On behalf of his own greatness and his own glory, he is ruling and reigning and empowering and controlling all things. Christ filling all things. It refers to his glory, his power, his sovereign prerogative to do everything he purposed, including give gifts to his servants to fulfill his mission. Christ has, as Hebrews says, passed through the heavens and been exalted above the heavens. As the psalmist said in Psalm 108, verse 5, "Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth." It's about the reign of Christ. There's nothing in the universe untouched by Christ. This refers to his glory, to him filling his inaugurated new creation temple, the church. What did Paul pray earlier on in Ephesians 3:17? He prayed that Christ would dwell in your hearts through faith. Dwell with all his glory. The Lord of the covenant, fulfilling his pledge to dwell with his people. Filling all things. It signifies Christ's presence in the church through his spirit. That Christ is the all-powerful conqueror of all the enemies of God's people in every corner of the universe. And he is equipping his people to fulfill his mission. And he is ruling through his church. Christ is seated at the right hand of God in the heavenly places, high above all evil powers, which lie subjected beneath his feet. And the victory was not merely for himself, but for his body. We in him, empowered and led and directed, fill every corner of the universe. We take the gospel to the ends of the earth. He fills all things. It's talking about the power of God. Earlier on in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 20 to 23, he talks about the power of God that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and above every name that is named, not only in this age but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. He is in control. He is reigning. He is sovereign. He is all-powerful. He is filling all things, and he is doing so for his glory. For his glory. The glory of the Lord. If you think back to the Old Testament manifestations of the glory of God associated with the presence of God, you see things like light and fire and cloud. It's a beautiful picture of the one who dwells, the holy God in mercy, dwelling with the undeserving. Glorious light dwelling on the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant in the Holy of Holies. God, a consuming fire, dwells with those who did not seek to dwell with him. God, who Moses interceded to for the people in their sin, "Lord, show me your glory." When Solomon dedicated the temple, the cloud filled the house of the Lord. The priest couldn't even stand to minister, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. Before the destruction of the Jerusalem temple, the glory of the Lord departed. The visible symbol of the presence of God was gone. And there was 400 years of silence. And 400 years later, in God's loving kindness, in his perfect timing, when the fullness of the time came, Galatians 4:4, the word became flesh and dwelt, literally tabernacled, literally pitched his tent among us, and we saw his, what? Glory, as Israel saw it in the tabernacle. Glory of the Father, Son, full of grace and truth. God's fulfillment of all the Old Testament shadows of glory. The ultimate manifestation of God's presence, Emmanuel, God with us. The radiance of his glory. God who said, "Light shall shine out of darkness." Paul said, has shone in the hearts of believers to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. He is the ultimate answer to Moses' prayer, Lord, show me your glory. Christ is the King of glory. Christ is the Lord of glory. Christ, the promised serpent slayer from Genesis 3, to come to restore the glory that sin ruined. And after Pentecost, at the moment of conversion, when you come to faith in Christ, you become a temple of the Holy Spirit. And God, through His Spirit, dwells in you. And just as His Spirit filled the Holy of Holies with glory when dedicated to Him, and that dramatic event is illustrated in every believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ in you, Colossians 1:27, the hope of glory. Now, some who say they're Christians seem, maybe sometimes at a moment in time, maybe sometimes through a season, seem not to be filled with the Spirit of God and the glory of God. And the glory seems to be eclipsed by sin and selfishness and worldly cares and even clouds the Lord's preeminence. You put them in a room of unbelievers and you can't tell the difference. Well, Christians are not called to coddle the flesh. They're called to deny themselves, and you're called to take up your cross and follow Christ. I mean, think about it. You wouldn't recognize the mercy and grace and love of Jesus if you didn't feel the weakness of your own sinful nature. That's why Paul would say, most gladly, I will boast about my weaknesses, that Christ's power may dwell on me, like the glory in the Holy of Holies, that all the riches of the glory of God in Christ are on that road, even marked with suffering for you, that we were able to be boasting in our weaknesses because the Lord of glory enables us to go through anything in life and experience His presence and His power in our time of need. Because He fills all things. And so, believer, you are kept by Christ, whom all things have been created through Him and for Him, and He's before all things, and in Him all things hold together. The testimony of every Christian is, Jesus is holding me together. Even to the point that Peter says, if you're reviled for the name of Christ, you're blessed. Because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Just as it did on Stephen as he was being killed. That's why Paul would say, with unveiled face, we are beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord through the Word of God, being transformed into the same image of the Son from glory to glory, even as from the Lord the Spirit. Christ fills all things. He controls all. And He does so in a world of sin that is affecting you and I. And our own sin keeps affecting us. And He is in control. And this world is dark. And it's not getting lighter in this moment. It's not getting better. But one day, God will make all things right. And Christ will return. And even like on a day like today, it's hard to remember the sun when the clouds are covering. And it's hard to remember those truths when the troubles are piling up. A misguided Christian said this week, ever since Christ, the world has been getting better, and it will continue to get better. I don't even answer questions like that, comments like that, because they're so ridiculous. The person selectively quoted some verses, left out much of the Old and New Testament. They left out verses such as 2 Timothy 3, 1-5. In the last days, there will come times of difficulty. People will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, treacherous, reckless, swollen with deceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Avoid such people. He left out 2 Timothy 3:12. All who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. While evil people and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. He left out 2 Timothy 4:2, preach the word, and 4:3, because people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears. They will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and they will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. This world is dark. It's not getting better. One day God will make all things right. Christ will appear a second time. His glory will be the most beautiful sight that we will see and experience throughout all eternity. Even now, as Paul said it, we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now we know in part, but then we will know fully, even as we have been fully known. But until then, the Christian is called to reflect the glory of God as children of God above reproach in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation and shine as lights in the world. We are to allow our light to shine before mankind in such a way that they would see our good works and glorify our Father who is in heaven. That with perseverance we wait for the appearing of the Son of Man coming on the clouds with power and great glory. He is filling all things with his glory. He is above all ruling and reigning. He is empowering the church. He is praying for the saints. He is preparing a place. He is preserving every believer. He is working for his eternal glory. Repetition of good things is good. So let me just repeat myself. I told you I would. Jesus descended. He died. He ascended. He rose. He rose again and went above, exalted. He descended to earth in the incarnation to die, to become sin for us. The Savior died for us. There's none better than him. He is perfect. Very God of very God, perfect Lamb, takes away the sins of the world. And he ascended. He passed into the highest heavens, location of his present ministry at this moment and his rule. In victory over Satan, sin, death, and hell, the king who rules over all, none is stronger than him. And he is exalted, so that now he fills the universe as king who joyfully lavishes his blessings upon his people, lavishes to his church the resources and the power to fulfill his mission. He is highest above all. And while the world may be getting worse, truth will triumph. God will save people and is continuing to save people and is saving people today, and he is sanctifying those he saves. He's making them more like Christ, even as he wills. Believer, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. He fills all things. God above fills all. He is above all, he fills all. He is the authoritative controller of all. He is the Lord of the universe. There is none greater than him. And the purpose for which he died and rose again, that Jesus might fill all things, that he might control all things, sovereign over the entire world. What is Christ doing now? He is praying for us. He is empowering us. He is filling the world with the gospel through the church. Fills his world through the church with the glory of the gospel. And this is really, if you think about these two verses, this is a description of the whole plan of salvation. That Christ coming to earth to die and be buried and rise on the third day and ascend back to the Father presently rules and has promised to return. And you might be asking today, why is this salvation needed? Is this one of those things where I'm good and he makes me a little better? Is it an upgrade? No, it's a transformation. He takes the dead and makes them alive. See, why is this fact that Jesus descended in death and ascended, rose again and went above, exalted, so important? It's so important because mankind is lost in sin and in slavery to Satan. The enemy entered the world. The devil, the enemy of God, pretended to be a friend of man, but is man's greatest enemy. And he conquered man and held him captive ever since. This is why Hebrews 2 tells us this. He partook of flesh and blood, that through death he might destroy the one who had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Man in sin, unsaved, is a slave of the devil under Satan's power. You're not an independent contractor, and you're not unaffiliated. It doesn't matter how good of a person we all think you are. Paul was told to preach the gospel so that God would open their eyes, the eyes of their hearts, and bring them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God. Satan attacked and defeated mankind and took him captive, and sin is slavery. You can't think that a life of sin is a life of freedom. It's the worst slavery. Think of all the people in the world who are slaves to substances and sex and 1,000 other things. And they talk about their freedom and they're slaves, and they cannot set themselves free. Try to break free of an addiction. You know what I'm talking about. All mankind under a curse, under God's just wrath, under condemnation that we cannot escape. You can't do some kind of, you know, Houdini escape from the chains of sin. Satan controls unbelievers and keeps them in bondage. Mankind is lost in sin and hates the truth and hates the light. And the high-handed pride of man knows no bounds and has no shame. Might dress it up, might look religious, but they rail against God and parade self-righteously and self-willed, arrogantly boasting of their autonomy. And God's judgment patiently waits. Christ died to conquer these enemies and set believers free and redeem the church and buy his people out of bondage and carry away our sin. The Lord conquered every enemy, conquered the last enemy. Every enemy that's ever enslaved man has been defeated. The work has been completed. He rose from earth to heaven. The disciples, they saw him on the Mount of Olives and saw him ascend into heaven to fill all things. They were promised this Jesus will return in the same way that you saw him go. He's highly exalted. He's been given the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee would bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. This is why we go to the ends of the earth with the gospel truth of Christ crucified, risen, buried, crucified, buried, risen, reigning now and returning. We make disciples of all nations because the Lord of glory, seated high above, put all enemies under his feet. He will return. For those who love him will be blessing. For those who hate him will be judgment. Because he alone is Lord. Christ alone is Lord. You have to surrender to him. You got to put your faith in him. You got to serve him. Those who believe in him are seated with him in the heavenly places, spiritually now, and one day actually. And anybody who gets saved by Jesus, they admit readily that they deserve nothing but hell. That everything else is icing or gravy. That God blesses you with all things to enjoy, but you never lose sight of the cross. That you know that the power to take a breath, to blink an eye, to take a step is enabled by God Almighty. That the believer is not their own, that every believer has been bought with a price, and therefore they need to glorify God in their body here on earth. That the believer can humbly speak with certainty, with absolute certainty in a very uncertain seeming world. That faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. That you don't see Jesus now, but you believe in him. And believer, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory. Jesus, the only name by which we can be saved. Absolute certainty. 100% exclusivity. Offered to all with no partiality. You know, there are so-called experts everywhere you turn. There might be some in the room, but none can save. Only Jesus. You can do the math, you can be curious, you can explore all the facts. At the end of the day, you will rest your soul on someone. And everything fails but Christ. If you can fog a mirror, if you can spit in the wind, you must decide. You must choose today who you will serve. You're not neutral. You're not independent. You're not unaffiliated. You belong to Satan or God. The Bible tells us the truth about God and about us. He is sovereign. We are sinful. He sent the substitute in our place, and we must surrender and stop dressing up human depravity, even disguising it as helping and flaunting man's ideas and strutting around Babel-like with human ingenuity. I can't wait to see how God confounds all plans and uses the wrath of man to praise him. Nothing escapes God's notice. Nothing. Man's evil plans will not assail. The gospel will prevail. Truth will triumph. Christ is ruling the universe with authority, from dead and buried to risen and reigning, and it points to an absolute certainty. If you're a Christian today, you can go to somewhere like Romans 8, 28 to 30, and read those first words. I know. I am convinced. I know. We know this. We know. We're convinced. We know that God works all things together for good to those called according to his purpose. Those he foreknew, he predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son. And if left to us, we would have airbrushed the Bible, made ourselves look better, and X'd out the gospel. We would have worked our way to heaven. If it was left to us, we would have made it all about us. We would have ruined everything. I don't know the condition of your soul. But I know that Jesus is the only one who can save you. And you cannot save yourself. And you cannot say it doesn't matter. What matters is who you belong to for eternity. It's either God or Satan. It's either Jesus or the enemy. And I pray that God would grant you repentance leading to the knowledge of the truth, that you would come to your senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will, that you would see Jesus, the only one who can forgive sins and want to do his will, and reject Satan, who's the most dangerous, sinister, evil, and too often deceivingly convincing taskmaster. Jesus is God Almighty. You surrender to him today. Bow before him today, before it's too late. Jesus died for sin. He rose again. He reigns now. He descended. He ascended to fill all things. He was born to die. He was risen to life. He is ruling now and forever. Jesus changes everything. And Lord, we thank you that that's not a Sunday school answer. That's the answer to everything. God the Son, Jesus Christ, came to earth to die in our place for our sins, rose from the dead, went back to heaven, seated at your right hand, praying for believers now, holding all things together by the word of his power, working all things after his will, that he died for sin, he rose again, reigns now. Thank you, Lord, even for giving every believer the privilege to preach Christ crucified and buried and risen and ascended and reigning and returning. Even that the needy would be filled and the mourning would rejoice and those devastated by sin's curse would have hope. We thank you, Lord. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Please stand if you're able and join as we close singing, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed.
Sacrifice to come.
For joining us for our Easter service today. Pray that you can take some time and fellowship with others outside. Today is a little different of a schedule. Next week we'll be back with a normal schedule. Worship services as usual, 8, 9, 30, and 11, but then also the children's ministry classes, junior high and high school, as well as adult Bible classes. So be ready for all of that. Anyway, let's finish with Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 and 21, and then I'll pray. Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. We thank you, Lord, that we can celebrate Jesus Christ risen from the dead, today and every day. Thank you, Lord, that we could sing your praises, pray, hear the word, respond with our hearts and our lives. Send us now by your grace for your glory to do your will. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sovereign in the mountain air.